2001 when I stopped the presidenting business. I'm in my office and I was teaching beginning economics, and two students came in and they complained about the price of textbooks. And I said, this is good stuff. This was Campbell McConnell's best-selling economics beginning book. And I said, you know, you need this. And they said, sort of why? And why can't we do alternate kinds of things? Can't we rent things? Can't we do other ways? Can't we proceed in a different direction? And I began to think about this. And I began to think about myself being in somewhat the same position as a medical doctor. You go in and the MD says, you need this prescription, and you go and you do that. And why do you do it? Because the MD is in a trust position. He or she says, you need this prescription, you go ahead and do it. I began to think, well, maybe textbooks, or the textbook market, isn't quite as competitive as we would like it to be, and I began to think about things like that. So this led in 2006 to my testifying before a congressional group on the economics of textbooks, and then I followed that up with turning the page just a couple of years ago for the Lumina Foundation, and lots of things have happened even since I did the Lumina report. And so I want to talk about the economics of textbooks, and I can assure you that I will probably offend quite a few people in the room as I go through the way an economist sees these kinds of issues. But this is really the heart of why we're here. If you look at these two lines, one is the CPI, that's the lower line, the Consumer Price Index, and the upper green line is the average increase in the price of new college textbooks. And you can see that one's lots higher than the other. Okay? Now, note that I said new. The CPI that the Bureau of Labor Statistics computes doesn't include used books or rental books and things like that. So this isn't really a true indicator of what students are paying, but it is an accurate indicator of what students are paying for new textbooks. But anyway, this is the attention getter. This is the place to really start. And I'm going to show you lots of numbers, and I always remember one of my mentors saying to me, if you torture the data long enough, they will confess. And so I'm going to torture a few numbers here and show you lots of data to try to back up what I'm talking about. But going back to that theme of a trust market, when you go to the MD, he or she is in a trust position, but then the same thing is true if you go and get auto repairs. I can't figure out automobiles anymore. I mean, I used to, years and years ago, mess with an automobile, but I can't do that anymore. I have to trust what they tell me, okay? And the same thing is true with the plumber. I don't know those kinds of things. So this is a trust market, and textbooks are rather like that for students with respect to faculty members. And the major problem here is that the person who is telling you to buy something isn't the person who has to pay for it, okay? And in 40 years in higher education, and I'm betraying my age here, I've never had a textbook salesperson come into my office and say, this is how much this book costs. They're always telling me about the new features, the DVDs, the workbooks, the learning tools, and so forth. And you have to really ask them what the textbook costs in order to get that, because they're not paying for it. It's the students who are doing that. Okay? Now, in the past, students really didn't have much in the way of alternatives. The internet wasn't really around for them to go and hunt for different prices. Used book markets were pretty limited. And most students, and I would include myself years and years ago, you just trusted the faculty member. You need to get this? Okay, I'll get that. And that's what we went ahead and did. But of course, that's changing quite a bit. But most trust markets haven't worked out very well. In fact, if you look at the rate of price increases for pharmaceuticals or for auto repairs or any of those other things that I mentioned, those are going up much more rapidly than the CPI. So in some ways, trust markets haven't really worked out terribly well for students. Let me put this in a different way. A lot of lines here, but the bottom line there is the CPI. From 1980 to 2012, and then the next line is new home prices, the next line is medical services, and finally that big blue purplish line at the top, that's textbooks.
So you can see textbook prices have been going up much more rapidly than everything else. But again, those are new textbooks. We're not talking about used textbooks or rental textbooks. Let's focus for a moment on the supply side of the market. Historically, colleges have had a conflict of interest. And I know this when I was a college president. You really love money that the state legislature can't come and take, that goes from year to year and doesn't end on June 30th. Well, textbook, college bookstore money is that sort of thing. It's one of those auxiliaries that you can keep on the campus. Well, if you're making money from the operation, you're getting a percentage of book sales and probably a fixed fee as well, you don't necessarily have a strong impetus to change that model, do you? You have a little bit of a conflict of interest there. We saw this recently, that bottom line there. George Washington University actually sent an email out to their faculty members saying, Follett has the franchise here. You need to patronize them. And of course, faculty members rose up in arms and they backed up and said, okay, we didn't really mean that quite so seriously. But that underlined the fact that a lot of colleges have an interest in the current circumstance. When economists talk about markets, they frequently talk about market concentration. How much of a market share do the largest producers have? And the textbook market is highly concentrated. The largest four publishers had 87.5% of the textbook market in 2008. And now the U.S. Department of Justice, which has a slightly different measure of concentration, is called the Herfindahl Index. The Herfindahl Index for the publishing industry is in the category where the U.S. DOJ says, hey, we would likely expect high prices, maybe restricted output and diminished innovation. That may or may not be true, but what we're talking about is a market that isn't as competitive as many of the markets that we would see. And of course, there's been a lot of consolidation. There's now a Big Five in publishing, and the Big Five have more than 90% of the new textbook market. And of the Big Five, only Pearson and McGraw-Hill are publicly traded. So we can get data on them and see their revenues, their profits, and I'm going to show you some of this in a moment. But for the other three, it's a little bit mysterious in terms of what they're actually doing. If you think about publishing strategies, and here I want to underline that this is how an economist looks at it. If you're a publisher out there, you may not like the way I'm describing this, but it's simply an economic way of looking at this. Bundling is a strategy where essentially you put a bunch of stuff together in a shrink wrap and you say, tell the student you have to buy it all. Well, federal law now precludes this, but some of the publishers and some of the bookstores are very clever. Let's say at the University of Georgia here, they will put a specific ISBN number on this package, but only at the University of Georgia. So if a student goes to the internet and says, I want to price out this package, he or she won't be able to find that ISBN anywhere else, so they can't comparison price. So they can't bundle, according to the law, but they can give a very specific ISBN that makes it difficult for students to shop around and find out what those particular books and support items would cost. Now, several of the publishers, I know McGraw-Hill is here, have done some really pretty interesting things, and I applaud them for some of the things they're doing to try to, as they say, make learning more active and to enable faculty members to test their students and for students to be able to test themselves along the way. In a sense, this is a substitute for bundling. What we don't know yet is how effective some of these are. We really need some rigorous control group studies of these particular approaches to determine whether or not this really is effective, whether students really learn more or less, and whether it's cost effective. But these are interesting and promising paths. Then another traditional strategy for publishers is to come out with a new edition. to make the previous editions artificially obsolescent. You can remember automobile producers doing that for years, and of course you know that Microsoft and Apple and people like that do it as just a matter of course. Pretty soon your old software doesn't work. Okay? Well, publishers essentially tell bookstores that we're not going to buy back those books, and so the bookstores then say, well, when the editions change, we're not going to buy those up from students anymore, which doesn't mean they won't still be out there on sale at the internet, but it greatly reduces their value. Then there's the reimportation issue, which until recently was a pretty significant thing. Many of the publishers have been price discriminating such that they're selling, or have been selling in the past, virtually the same textbook internationally at a much lower price. And so you could buy pretty much the same thing in India or Poland or someplace like that for a much lower price. Of course, there's a natural tendency then, economically speaking, for somebody to want to import books. And the publishers made people sign agreements that they wouldn't re-import books because that would drive down the prices of the books that they're selling inside the United States. 2013, a U.S. Supreme Court decision said, look, the doctrine of first sale now applies to textbooks. First sale is like with an automobile. If you buy an automobile, you can resell it to anybody you want. But for textbooks, that wasn't allowed previously. There were contracts that prohibited that. And the U.S. Supreme Court said, we're going to apply the doctrine of first sale to textbooks as well. Okay? Well, since, let me sort of pull this together, since World War II, textbook markets have generated results that aren't nearly as favorable as what you would have seen in other markets. If you think about PCs, for example, marvelous technological change there, and the prices have fallen, and they've really been good for consumers, but textbooks not so much so. But there's lots of change in the textbook market. Lots of things going on now that I want to talk about that really are making textbooks, I think, a much better market for student consumers than they've been before. 85% of all students now purchase some of their textbooks online. And of course, years ago, that was not possible. And these marketing tactics that I've talked about on the part of publishers, they're diminishing in terms of their importance and their ability to really pull this off. This is a sample of seven major textbooks. Economics, German, engineering, a variety of different fields, and I priced them out. And you can see on the far left here, this is the list price for a new textbook, and you start going down to Amazon, Amazon used, ebooks, paperbacks, international edition, and Chegg, renting them. And you can see there are a lot of different possibilities out there now. Well, that didn't used to be out there, did it? Those possibilities simply weren't there, but they are now, and that's one of the reasons why textbook markets now are much more favorable to our students than they were before. How are publishers doing? Well, some are struggling. Now, Cengage went bankrupt, but it really wasn't because they didn't have a cash profitable operation. It's rather because they assumed lots of debt in a takeover. But some of the publishers aren't doing very well at all. But if we look at some profit rate data here, the purple one there is the profit rate on sales in publishing. And you can see 10%. That's lots higher than is true in a couple of other industries, lower than in some others. Okay? And if you look at what's happened to these profit rates over the last few years, they've gone up in publishing, which is interesting overall. They've gone up and they've gone down in some other areas as well. Okay? Here's McGraw-Hill. It's a public company. We know what's going on there. The revenue is going up primarily because they, like lots of the major publishers, have been raising prices. But you can see McGraw-Hill's profit rate's actually been declining. Well, that's because they're running into more competition. It's getting more expensive for them to do some of the things that they've done in the past. There are costs of competition and the like that they've run into that they didn't have previously. Okay? So there's evidence then that the internet, the used market, rentals, and so forth are making a difference in terms of publishers' profit margins. So if you want to put this together, we're talking about innovation that is disrupting the usual models. And Clayton Christensen at Harvard is really the guy who sort of coined this term of disruptive innovation and disruptive development. Here is two major books, both worth reading, but that's what's happening in the textbook area. Now, approximately two-thirds of all textbook units the students are purchasing now are used, rented, borrowed, copied, stolen, whatever, okay? Only about one-third of all the books out there that students are buying are new textbooks from the publisher. And the typical student downloads 1.2 textbooks per semester from probably illegal sharing sites. Okay. Now, that's interesting. You can look at these data right here about what students think about this, and you can say the glass is half empty or half full. I look at this and say maybe it's closer to half empty, because most students don't think this is a problem. If they want to go download something, they're going to go download it. It's like a movie. If it's a textbook, they're going to go download it if they want to, and they're not really worried so much about the legality of it. And Student Monitor now says that used textbooks and purchases and e-books now together, they're almost up to 50%. E-books are maybe up to 8 or 10% of the market. And I'm going to come back to e-books in a moment, because the evidence on e-books is pretty mixed in terms of what students think about them, and for that matter, what faculty members don't think about them. But look at that bottom dot. 10 to 30% of students, depending on whom you believe, don't buy anything at all. They simply eschew buying a textbook. Why? Well, the top reason, according to Student Monitor, is they say they can't afford it. But frequently, they're sharing a book with someone else, or they're using online materials, or you can see all the reasons. Students have lots and lots of reasons why they're not buying textbooks, but many simply aren't doing it. As a consequence, not only are print book sales declining, and this is textbooks and trade books as well, but textbook print sales are going down. This is from the Wall Street Journal. No surprise, we've sort of seen this occurring out there, but that's one of the things that publishers are dealing with out there. And as a consequence, students aren't spending as much on textbooks. And you can see the downward trend, and this is the best evidence, best economic evidence, that the market for textbooks is changing. That online possibilities, that rentals, that used books and so forth are really biting into the conventional publishing model. But it's interesting that both Apple and Amazon have said that they intend to get into the used ebook business. Now, this is really going to be interesting, because if you think about an ebook, there are substantial fixed costs, overhead, in terms of producing that. But the marginal incremental cost of producing an extra ebook is very small. It might cost a dollar or something to produce, or 50 cents to produce an additional ebook. Okay? Well, if these people get into competition with each other, if I can produce an ebook for a dollar, then any price above a dollar, I'm going to make money. I'll get back some of my fixed costs and actually run a profitable operation. In this kind of a circumstance, we would expect almost like the sorts of things we've seen in some of the digital pricing markets, where the price of these items gets pushed down and down and down almost to zero. That might happen for ebooks if these kinds of competitors get into the market. Now, one of the most interesting developments out there, I think, is what Indiana University, the entire system, has done. They've negotiated really low prices with the major publishers for digitized versions of textbooks. Essentially, students pay a laboratory fee, okay? And they pay that fee, and then they get electronic textbooks. But as I point out here, these discounts are from what? Well, it's from the list price. And IU says that nobody ever pays more than 35% of the list price for the textbooks, the electronic textbooks they get as a part of this deal. But the list price, I won't say is a made-up price, but it doesn't necessarily reflect the cost of production. The cost of generating an additional electronic textbook, again, is really pretty small. So this is still a profitable operation for the publishers. Indiana University also has been successful in separating the material from the delivery platform. They're using course load, and they've separated that, and as Brad Wheeler told me, he said they wanted to control the mixing bowl, which is a rather scenic way of saying that. But Indiana now controls the mechanism for putting this stuff out. And the publishers basically like this. And here are the reasons why. I mean, it's a reliable stream of income for them. No drop-off in sales after the first year, as you always see in print books, where there's a precipitous decline. And faculty know that all the students in their course actually have a book, an electronic book, and they can update the materials. So this is a model that publishers generally like. But it doesn't necessarily always work out well. One reason is that faculty have diminished incentives to actually do this. If I'm an Indiana University Bloomington faculty member and I'm paid for publishing, that's how I get tenure, that's how I get rewarded, learning how to do an ebook is maybe farther down on my list. And it turns out that students in repetitive surveys in the Indiana University system and nationwide tell us that they don't really especially like ebooks. Some do, but a majority don't react to these things very favorably. But there is a learning by doing phenomenon here. The more faculty members use these things, the better they get at it. So if they make an investment, they can help students learn and use the materials more effectively in the classroom. But again, there's not a huge incentive for them to do this because their promotion and tenure guidelines typically don't include things like that. The California State University system is doing much the same thing, a much larger system. It's a very interesting and I think, again, productive way to go, because they're able to really negotiate down prices and reduce the cost to students, which is their major goal. But the especially interesting thing about Indiana is they're offering a free ride to anybody. They're giving out all of their intellectual property. They're saying, we'll show you how to do this if you want to do it. And I think that's remarkable, frankly, that they've invested all the resources they have, and now they're saying to any other campus, any other system, you can come and take what we have and we won't charge you for it. Meanwhile, the publishers, of course, aren't sitting still. They founded the Big Five CourseSmart in 2007. It's now owned by an outfit called Vital Source. And Vital Source says that they have 30,000 textbooks out there that people can purchase electronically. And of course, Vital Source is interested in this sort of laboratory fee approach that I just described at Indiana University, because it gives them a reliable source of revenue and the like. And then there are lots of intriguing other possibilities out there involving open platforms and open source kinds of textbooks. And for example, OpenStax, they've reported, they probably have a higher number than this now, but more than 500,000 book downloads. These are very promising avenues to go. I mentioned a couple of other possibilities there, and there's Flat World Knowledge, one of the real pioneers in this area. Flat World Knowledge, though, has kind of found the going financially a little bit tough, and so they're branching out into software and learning platforms. And this final paragraph is really a very important one. All of the open source, open platform models or approaches are struggling to find a way, frankly, to pay for it. Getting money from the Gates Foundation is not a long-run solution. It's not a business model. You have to eventually pay all the people who supply resources. And I'm sounding like an economist now, but in the long term, whether we're talking about faculty or authors or distributors or publishers or bookstores, they have to make money or they won't continue to do what they're doing. And that's the struggle that most of the open source, open platform people are doing. So you put all this stuff together, where are we? Well, we're in a time period when there are really fundamental changes going on in the textbook market. So much so that it's a little bit difficult to predict where we will be even 10 years from now. Joseph Schumpeter, the long-dead Harvard economic historian, talked about perennial waves of creative destruction. And that's what's happening in the textbook market. But frankly, that's the way of a market economy. That's the way of capitalism. If you look at all these firms I've listed on the bottom, they're all dead. Every one of those firms along the bottom there no longer exists. They're in the graveyard. And what I'm trying to suggest to you is we're probably going to see somewhat the same thing in publishing and in bookstores and among rental firms and so forth. The entire textbook industry is going to be a part of this creative destruction. And the most persuasive evidence of this is the amount that students are spending. It's going down. And then also that the total number of bookstores, as I think I pointed out before, has gone from 10,000 nationally to 3,000. There are real changes going on there that are unlikely to turn around. Well, what are students doing instead of buying textbooks? New textbooks, anyway. Well, used textbooks. And Chegg is one of the major suppliers there, and I've listed some of the others, were given their logos along the bottom. But even Chegg has found this a tough business model to make money at. And they branched out into tutoring. In fact, Chegg advertises as the Uber for tutoring, which may not be such a good slogan here recently. Maybe not such a good idea. But Chegg is a major firm, but they're finding trouble making money at this. Of course, some students rent books. And some rent them from their own institutions. In fact, years and years ago, I mean, when I was an undergraduate at Illinois State University, they rented textbooks there. And they got away from it. But there are some institutions like Eastern Illinois, Southeast Missouri, most of these smaller institutions in the University of Wisconsin system, lots of community colleges that rent textbooks to their students. And there's much to be said for that. It reduces the cost of textbooks to students about 75%. Many faculty members, though, don't like this. Because in order to have a successful rental system, first of all, you have to invest a lot of money in inventory and a store and the like, but you have to pretty well use a textbook for 3 or 4 or 5 years. And many faculty members say, I don't want to be tied into that. And some faculty members make the academic freedom argument. Don't tell me what textbook I have to use. But rental systems really do save a lot of money. Many students, roughly 8 to 10%, seem to purchase less expensive ebooks, or they use open platform, open source things. And incidentally, I would include MOOCs in the electronic category as well. I don't know whether you've thought of a MOOC as a textbook, but a massively open online course with all these segments is almost like a textbook. And in some cases could be assigned in that fashion by a faculty member and instead of a regular textbook and at a price of zero. A lot of students from the surveys rent or share or borrow textbooks, and then again, 10 to 30% of students don't buy a textbook at all. Last spring, I was teaching a large managerial economics course, and I had about 30 or 40 students in front of me, and then roughly 200 students spread around the country and around the world. Well, after their grades were in, I said, well, your grade's determined, nothing's going to change. Did you buy a textbook? Did you rent a textbook? Did you share a textbook? What did you do? And they told me what they did, and then 12% said, I didn't buy anything at all. And I am probably partially at fault for that because I have a very well-developed Blackboard site. And I have all my lectures up there and the PowerPoint slide and readings and all kinds of learning tools and assistance features. And they said, you've got it all up there. I don't need to buy the textbook. So I probably shot myself in the foot there if I wanted them to buy textbooks. But that's something to keep in mind, because to the extent that we develop learning alternatives, people will not buy textbooks. This kind of summarizes what I just showed you. And these are approximate percentages. And you can't see the bottom there, unfortunately. So that's not going to do you much good. And I don't know how to move that up. So I'm not going to try to adjust that. But these are percentages of students doing various kinds of things. It simply summarizes what I said before. Let's talk about a couple of issues that I think are important. First of all, what about this Bureau of Labor Statistics textbook price index? It's pretty deceptive, as I think I've already pointed out. It doesn't include used books and rental books and the like. So when we see textbook prices going up like this, it's true for new textbooks, but it doesn't really reflect the overall tenor of what's happening in the textbook market. So that textbook price index is becoming increasingly irrelevant because students are doing more and more renting and using more used books and e-books and so forth, so that price index is telling us less and less as the years pass. Now, in BLS's defense, they can't really go out and compare used books to new books, and some books have been trashed and some of them have been written in. They can't compare all those things. It would be impossible. So they really can't do much of an index that includes those other things. In textbook rental systems, you know, were very common in the past, but not so much today. Well, anyway, as I pointed out, textbook rental systems are a good way to reduce student costs. But faculty members resist, and some universities resist as well, because there's a considerable investment involved. Okay, issue three, and I can see we skipped over something there. What about e-books? Well, we're still at the very beginning in terms of determining, I think, how effective they are and how much students learn. We really need, badly need, rigorous control group studies of what students are learning. Do they really use the things? Do they get together and work with each other as often? Do they keep these over time? The answer for that is mostly no, because typically the intellectual property rights expire for the students at the end of a semester or the end of their undergraduate career. Okay? So let's now make some predictions here. First of all, adjusted for inflation, the average student is going to end up spending less on textbooks in the future than they've spent on the past. And if you're a publisher, that's not such good news. But it simply reflects what's going on, the increased number of alternatives that students have, and the creative destruction of the textbook market. I'm going to guess on number two that e-books 10 years from now might account for about 1/3 of all the textbook purchases, new, used, rental, whatever. That's something of a guess, because right now there's all this evidence out here that students don't really like e-books. Here's a little bit of that evidence. If you look at this evidence, it says, well, that only about half of the students out there are, 44% are somewhat or very happy with e-books, and 39% are unhappy. I mean, that's not a very favorable result if I'm trying to sell e-books. And interestingly, there's a gender difference. Women students dislike e-books more than male students. Here's another little bit of this evidence. And again, if we're talking about glasses half full and half empty, I'd say this is more than half empty, because the results indicate that not really very many students say that they prefer e-books, or that they study lots with e-books, or that they really like what's going on there. Okay, a third prediction. To the extent that institutions can get together, like the Indiana University model, the California State University model, perhaps this will occur now in Georgia as well, and together they exercise what economists call monopsony power, buyer power, we can really bid down the prices of textbooks that way. Again, if you're a publisher in the room here, that's not necessarily good news for you, but if it does result in the laboratory fee kind of model, publishers are going to get that regular, dependable revenue stream, and faculty members are going to know that the students in the room actually have a copy of the book. Reimportation, we've really talked about that before. What we've seen now is books being reimported back into the United States. One of the things I asked my students in that managerial economics course is, well, how many of you bought a book from, let's say, Blackwell's or someplace? And the answer was about 5%. And that's now because it's legal to do that without any problems. And we will see, I think, more people importing books from abroad to narrow the price difference. This is a more controversial prediction, perhaps, but if you look what's going on, it's, I think, almost inevitable that a couple of the major publishers are going to bite the dust, or that smaller ones will. And there are pervasive economic reasons for this. One is that they really can't deal well with digitization and ebooks and the like. And the second is there are tremendous economies of scale in publishing. And if you're not big and you can't move down that cost curve, you are less efficient than the other competitors and you simply eventually get driven to the wall. One of the interesting things about digitized markets in general, whether we're talking about textbooks or software or the like, is that big fixed costs, very low marginal costs or incremental costs in producing, so the average cost curve goes down, 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 and the bigger you are, the more efficient you are. And it certainly looks now as if we're headed in that direction. Six, if Apple really decides to get into this game and produce e-textbooks at low prices, they're really going to turn the industry upside down. And number seven is the same kind of thing. If Apple and Amazon really get into ebooks and reselling used ebooks, and that's legal and the like, that's really going to turn things upside down. But Amazon is really a major player in all this, as we've seen recently in the arguments they've had and the agreements they've made with Hachette and so forth. They're a tremendously large and important competitor. Look at these numbers. 40% share of the new book market, 62% of all books sold online, and 64% of the overall e-book market. I mean, Amazon is literally, as I say here, the 10-ton gorilla in a room full of ordinary-sized monkeys. If Amazon really wants to get involved in the textbook market, they're going to change it just by themselves. And it's difficult to predict exactly what direction they're going to go and whether or not they can make money at this. But if they think they can make money at it, they're in a very important market position now. Now, if Amazon comes in, this is going to drive down book prices. And that's good for students, okay? Not so good for publishers and not so good perhaps for authors. If you're a faculty author, you're probably talking about lower royalties, and eventually we might have problems in terms of who's going to produce the material. Here's a picture from the Wall Street Journal the day that Amazon made its deal with Simon & Schuster. And they were very clever about this because they made the deal with Simon & Schuster and they sort of picked off the smaller publishers one by one and then they went after Hachette and eventually did a deal with them. Number nine, college bookstores are going to continue to evolve, which is a nice way of saying they're not going to be so much booksellers in the future. In fact, many of them are not that right now. The majority of their revenue is coming from computers and food and coffee and other kinds of things. That will continue. Doesn't mean that you won't continue to buy some books there, but you're going to buy lots of other things there if you are a student. College bookstores are sort of doing okay, though. Students now are only buying, according to Student Monitor, 41% of their books online. So they're still going into stores and doing this. And the interesting thing is that hasn't changed much over the last few years. Pretty much constant here, as you see, the proportion of books that students say they're buying online. And with that, I'm going to stop, and perhaps you have questions that you would like to drill me with, and we'll see. Yes.
Well, one question I have is about a number of the affordability strategies that you outlined end up with students losing access to materials. Sometimes these are called disappearing ink strategies. So if I rent a book, I have to give it back at the end of the term. If I get an ebook, the DRM expires at the end of the term, it deletes itself. And we kind of send a mixed message to students telling them that these courses are so important, we won't let you graduate unless you take them. And then on the other side we say, it doesn't matter, sell the book back at the end of the, you're never gonna look at this again, you're never gonna use it again. And I just wonder what you think about this mixed messaging that they get, and if there are other strategies that don't result in students losing all their access to materials at the end of term that look promising in terms of affordability going forward.
That's a good question. Most of the rental outfits give students the ability to buy the book at the end of the rental time period. So they really can do that. And even back at Illinois State University in the 1960s, I bought quite a few of the economics textbooks and so forth that I ran, a lot of history things and so forth. So that really is out there. The more difficult problem relates to ebooks. In the Indiana University case, they've tried to negotiate agreements whereby students can keep the intellectual property rights until they graduate, but they don't keep them forever. And that's an issue as well, because if you're taking, let's say, beginning calculus, you'd probably like to have that calculus book available for the rest of your engineering career or your economics career or chemistry career or whatever. And so that really is a problem. But that's negotiable, it seems to me. And if people like Amazon and Apple get into the used ebook market, then everything's going to be possible. Then everybody's going to have the intellectual property rights to books for as long as they want them. So I think the electronic digital part of that particular issue is a difficult one now, but it looks like that's negotiable, and if Apple and Amazon get in, that will just completely take care of that issue. Yes?
So one of the examples you gave was about micro-funding. So students at IU, for example, spending a small amount of money to get access to commercially produced textbooks at a lower price. One of the things, so full disclosure, I work at Creative Commons, and we produce open licenses that you can use open textbooks.
You have a couple of my licenses.
That's right. You can use them for free and keep them forever and not lose your access. So one of the things that we do in the open community is we use the same strategy. We pool small amounts of money, oftentimes from student fees, and then collectively produce openly licensed textbooks that are of high quality and can be distributed and kept forever, modified to meet local needs, et cetera. Although that's an emerging model for us. And so I'm wondering if there are other industries that you've seen as an economist where big user communities who've had a need have pooled small amounts of money to perform a collective action for the good of the community, and they've had the rights, the legal rights, to sustain and maintain their access to those goods.
There actually are some industries like that, or some markets like that, where people can buy small segments of vacation time and things like that, where they couldn't afford to buy the entire condo themselves, but they can buy a portion of that. So that model exists out there in a variety of industries. The problem is, again, how you make this a profitable thing. It's somewhat related to sort of the entire open platform problem. because in the long term, people don't continue to do things unless it's profitable for them to do so. And maybe we wish that weren't so, but that's generally the way it is. And I think that's the major problem there. Can we devise profit streams and revenue streams that will make all the participants happy over a long period of time? I personally hope that's the case, because that's a very interesting way to approach reducing the costs of students.
So can I ask a follow-up?
Yeah.
So in higher education, particularly public higher education like this institution, they have missions that are, and they're publicly funded to pursue those missions. And as you pointed out, it's not all public money. There's a mix of funding sources. But as a community, is it possible, do you think, for higher education, particularly public higher education, to act with the significant amounts of money that they're spending today on textbooks, as an example, collectively, and profit isn't the main goal or necessarily the main need? So I guess I would argue, A, there's plenty of money today that's spent, and an open solution is a very small percentage of what we're spending today on textbooks. And if that's so, is it possible for us to act on our collective vision and need and want for an educated citizenry versus a need for profit?
The open solution is a neat one, and I hope it succeeds, but many of the major participants, like the publishers and so forth, aren't going to do things for nothing. The authors aren't going to do things for nothing. And the universities have this conflict of interest where they're raking in considerable amounts of money. So I hope you succeed, but this is a tough group of participants to crack, because they all have a financial interest in things not happening that way.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kopp. Yes. We appreciate your time today.
Thank you.